Good afternoon, colleagues. We're going to begin shortly with First Minister's questions, but before we do, I think the First Minister will give us an update on the COVID-19 situation. First Minister.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. I will give a very short update on the daily statistics. The total number of positive cases that were reported yesterday is 668. That is 10.8% of people who were newly tested yesterday, and that takes the total number of confirmed cases now to 29,912. 244 of these new cases are in Greater Glasgow and Clyde, 166 in Lothian and 123 in Lanarkshire. The remaining 135 are spread across 9 other health board areas. There are 154 people in hospital as of today. That is an increase of 15 from yesterday. And I should point out to the Chamber that it is also an increase of 70 since I updated the Chamber at this time last week. There are 17 people in intensive care. That is an increase of 2 since yesterday. And I regret to report that in the past 24 hours, 3 additional deaths have been registered of patients who first tested positive in the previous 28 days. And the total number of deaths under that daily measurement is now 2,522. And of course, I offer my condolences to everyone who has lost a loved one. We will also shortly publish our latest estimate of the R number, as we do every Thursday. The estimate today confirms our view that the R number is currently above 1, and it is possibly as high as 1.7. Now, that partly reflects the impact of the outbreaks we've seen in the last 2 weeks, including in student accommodation. But as a point of perspective, it's also worth stressing that because this estimate, as the R number always does, relies on past data, it doesn't yet take account of any impact of the new measures we announced last week. However, all of these figures that I've just reported, I think, demonstrate why we announced those measures last week, because it is imperative to get the virus back under control. These figures also explain why I will confirm to the Chamber today, as I gave an indication of last week, that we are postponing the route map changes for which we had previously given an indicative date of 5th October. I hope members will agree that it would not be sensible to ease restrictions that are still in place while infection rates are rising, and we are working to bring them back down. We will review these restrictions again by the 15th of October. However, if we need to take further action before that to curb the spread of the virus, we will not hesitate to do so, but of course we will report that to Parliament. For the moment, the key way of bringing the virus back under control is for all of us to stick to the current rules and guidance. So I'll round off again by just briefly setting out what we are all being asked to do. With some limited exceptions, nobody should be visiting each other's homes at the moment. When we are outdoors or in indoor public places, we mustn't meet in groups of any more than 6 people from a maximum of 2 households. We're also asking everyone to work from home if possible, not to car share unless essential, and to download the Protect Scotland app. More than 1.3 million of us have now done this, and I can advise the Chamber that the app has already notified more than 2,000 people of the need to self-isolate. And of course, some of these would not otherwise have been contact traced at all. And finally, I would remind everybody to remember facts. Face coverings, avoid crowded places, clean hands and hard surfaces, keep 2 metres distance and self-isolate and book a test if anyone experiences any of the symptoms of COVID. Thank you, Presiding Officer, for the opportunity to provide this update.
Thank you very much, First Minister. I just remind members that under the current procedures, we'll take all the supplementaries after question 7, but feel free to press your button should you wish either a constituency or a general open supplementary at any point. Question number 1, Ruth Davidson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In January 2019, the First Minister said that the Committee on the Scottish Government's Handling of Harassment Complaints, also referred to as the Salmond Inquiry, will be able to request whatever material they want, and I undertake today that we will provide whatever material they request. The inquiry has requested material, the Government has rejected it. What has made the First Minister break her word?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I take these matters very seriously. I take this inquiry very seriously, as I think all of us should do, and I don't think that is an accurate characterisation of the position. The only, as I understand it, and I'll come back to say why I'm couching it in that way in a second, the only material that hasn't been provided by the Scottish Government is material where there are legal reasons that cannot be provided, including, of course, the issue of legal privilege, which all organisations will have regard to. But as I understand it, and this is publicly available, there has been over 1,000 pages of material made available by the government. Government officials have given over 10 hours of oral evidence so far. And the government has intimated to the committee that it intends to initiate legal proceedings to try to get into a position where it can make available more material that currently it can't do for reasons of legal restriction. Now, the final point I'd make on the government, all of what I've just said there is in the public domain. I have recused myself from decision-making over the Scottish Government submissions, and I advised Parliament of that way back at the outset. And the reason for that is very simple, and I think absolutely right. Part of the remit of this committee is looking at my conduct. And I think it would be wrong if I was the minister taking decisions about the content of Scottish Government submissions. And if I was in that position, I'm prepared to bet, presiding officer, that Ruth Davidson and others would be standing up here saying that that was deeply wrong and improper. But let me turn to my position. And again, I'm just interested in putting the facts out here, presiding officer. And I'm not sure, for those who are not on the committee, how much what I'm about to say is understood. The committee has now for 2 months been in possession of substantial written evidence from me personally. That's not been published, and that's entirely the committee's decision. But it's a bit galling for me to hear often members of the committee from the Conservative benches somehow saying I'm not answering questions. I also stand ready, presiding officer, to give oral evidence to this committee at any point it chooses to call me. I have not yet been invited to give oral evidence to this committee. So, you know, these accusations that somehow I am not cooperating with this committee have no substance to them at all. I have done everything the committee has asked of me, and I will continue to do so because I am respecting the process of this committee, and I am starting to think that that is perhaps the difference between me and those on the Conservative benches.
Ruth Davidson.
Presiding officer, I know that the Nicola Sturgeon, who is First Minister, likes to pretend that she's not the Nicola Sturgeon that's also leader of the SNP, but I'm struggling to believe that the Nicola Sturgeon, who committed to this chamber to give the inquiry whatever material it requested from her government 18 months ago, is not the same Nicola Sturgeon that stands here today saying I've recused myself and it's nothing to do with me, Gov. Now, I think the important thing here is that there was something that the First Minister there that said that was correct. And that was that yesterday we saw something utterly unprecedented. A committee convener of this parliament forced to write to the courts for access to documents that it needs because Scottish Government ministers refused to hand them all over. And she's been forced to do so because, in her own words, we had hoped to be in a position to hear further oral evidence, but with responses still outstanding from the Scottish Government, the Chief Executive of the SNP and the former First Minister, all of this means that we simply cannot proceed at this stage. Well, as head of the Scottish Government and as leader of the SNP, two of these demands fall directly under the gift of the First Minister. She can ensure that this evidence is provided with a snap of her fingers. So why won't she?
First Minister.
Interestingly, the letter from the committee convener about seeking the court's permission to publish material, the Scottish Government had already intimated to the committee that it was going to initiate legal proceedings in order to put itself in a position, hopefully, where it can provide material that currently it cannot provide because of legal restrictions. So the Scottish Government actually wants and is intending to do exactly that. The material that has not been provided is material that can't be provided for one legal reason or another. Other than that, as I said, 1,000 or more pages of material, 10 hours of oral evidence on the part of Scottish Government officials have already been given. I think it's important for a whole variety of reasons to take this committee seriously. In terms of my role as party leader, there was a request made for evidence from the SNP. And again, this is all in the public domain. It can be found on the committee's website. That request was acceded to. Evidence was given by the deadline the committee asked for, and people can go and read the request and the answers that were given. The committee then made further requests. It didn't put actually a deadline on those further requests, but that material is currently being prepared. The idea that the Scottish Government or the SNP is trying to obstruct this committee bears no scrutiny whatsoever. But I come back to this point, Presiding Officer. I have been asked to give evidence to the committee in a personal capacity. I did that 2 months ago. I gave substantial written evidence to the committee. It is not down to me that that hasn't been published yet. I stand ready any time, today, next week, the week after that, to turn up at this committee and give evidence to it orally. I have not had an invitation to do that yet. And yet, and when I said earlier on that I suspected some of the Conservatives' motives here, I was met with a cry of "that's outrageous." Well, let me say why I fear that, Presiding Officer. Because I have given that written evidence. I stand ready when I'm invited to give oral evidence. And yet, despite presumably knowing that, the Conservative member of the committee almost every week issues political comment to the effect that I am not answering questions. It starts to sound to me, Presiding Officer, like it doesn't matter to the Conservatives what evidence any of us give. They've already made up their mind about the outcome they want this committee to have.
Ruth Davidson.
And yet the funny thing is, Presiding Officer, the question that I asked her related to a quote from the SNP convener of that committee. So I don't think it's just a party political issue. But if the Scottish Government is not going to fully cooperate with this inquiry, and if the First Minister is not going to keep her word that, quote, she'll provide whatever material they request, then I'm afraid she leaves us no option but to come here and ask questions directly to her face. So let me ask her this. In recent days, private messages purporting to come from the SNP's chief executive, Peter Murrell, have been published in the media. Messages which say it is, quote, a good time to be pressurising, unquote, police. And to be honest, quote, the more fronts he is having to firefight on, the better for all complainers, unquote. He, in this case, being Alex Salmond. We don't know whether these messages actually come from the SNP chief executive or not. The messages were passed to the committee inquiry, and it deserves answers. So let me directly ask the First Minister, who is also the leader of the SNP, are these messages genuine or not?
First Minister.
As I understand it, the obtaining of messages and the passing of these messages to the committee, and it appears to me that when they were passed to the committee, they immediately leaked to the media. That is how it appears to me. But the obtaining of these messages is currently a matter, as I understand it, of a police investigation. Now, I am happy to answer any questions before this committee that they want to. But people are saying, answer them. This committee has not asked me. I am not standing here, Presiding Officer, and I don't think it is reasonable for me to be asked questions about things that other people might or might not have done. Call the people who the messages are purported to come from and ask them the questions. Call me and I will answer for myself. The issue here, Presiding Officer, is that I am willing. The committee can convene this afternoon and I will answer questions for my conduct before that committee. It is outrageous that I am in a position right now of having given written evidence to this committee 2 months ago. It hasn't been published. That's not down to me. I've not been invited to give evidence to the committee, and yet I am somehow been accused of not being prepared to answer questions and in Parliament being expected to answer on behalf of other people. If people want to take this seriously, then treat the committee process with respect and take it seriously.
Ruth Davidson.
My understanding, Presiding Officer, that the police inquiry is about how the SNP's former Justice Minister received the messages, and that does not preclude the First Minister from saying whether they are genuine or not, and she knows that. Now, throughout this affair, the First Minister's excuse has been that she can swap hats whenever it suits her. Nicola Sturgeon, who leads the SNP, isn't the same person as Nicola Sturgeon, who runs the Scottish Government, and it is a complete nonsense. And it hides the real truth here, which is the shabby abuse of power that this affair has revealed. We have the head of the civil service having to be recalled to the inquiry because she can't remember or won't answer key questions, a tranche of government emails related to the inquiry deleted, committee hearings having to be suspended because they can't continue due to obstruction, and a committee chairwoman having to write to the courts to get information that the First Minister promised 18 months ago that she would undertake to provide. 2 years ago, Nicola Sturgeon told the media with regards to the Salmond case, I relish the prospect to answer all and every questions. Well, on today's performance, the question is, when's she going to start?
First Minister.
Okay. I've not been invited to give evidence to the committee, so here, well, here it is. I'll turn up to the committee next week and give evidence to the committee if the committee invites me. I gave written evidence to it, meeting its deadline 2 months ago. That hasn't been published. Let me be very clear. I respect the committee's right to decide what it publishes and when, but I can't be held responsible for the fact that evidence I've submitted hasn't yet been published. I can't be held responsible for the fact that the committee hasn't yet invited me to give evidence. I am trying to respect the process of the committee. The committee can call me any time it likes. I will turn up on the date it asked, the committee room it asked, and I will give evidence to the committee. It hasn't yet asked me to do so.
Question to Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yesterday, the Universities Minister told Parliament, and I quote, "We decided that asking students to all stay at home and begin their courses online would have inflicted significant harm on them." This morning, I spoke to Adam, a first-year drama student in Glasgow. He told me that he's been here a week and a half, he's only spoken to two people in his class, and he can't access the rehearsal space in his accommodation. Last night on the BBC, a student nurse who worked for 5.5 months on a COVID ward described how she's now having to isolate in a 6x8 room. Does the First Minister really think that these students are better off than they would have been if they were studying from home?
First Minister.
I think that is a really difficult thing to judge, to be honest, because I think whatever decision is taken in these issues, people will suffer detriment. And that actually is the nature of all of the decisions we're taking around COVID right now. It's something I am conscious of every single day, that when we take a decision to try to reduce harm in one area, there is the potential for us to create harm in another area. So we make the best balanced judgments that we can. And what we sought to do, and you know, governments across the UK and many other parts of the world have reached the same decisions, is to ensure that we give as many young people as possible the opportunity for a degree of normality in their university or college education while taking important steps to mitigate the risk of the transmission of the virus. Now, yes, you can argue, and it's not an illegitimate thing to argue, that we should just have kept everybody at home, but there would have been harm done to students there. They would have been denied the opportunity to have the links and make the connections that come with being in a campus environment, because university is about more than lectures and academic learning. So what we did is put in place substantial guidance to make sure that universities take the right steps, and we continue to work with universities to ensure that that is the case. And the welfare of students at this point should be the paramount interest of universities, and we continue to liaise with them very closely to make sure that's the case.
Richard Leonard.
Well, let's talk about the decision-making process. The First Minister talks about substantial guidance. It is, because in the past 7 days, students have been given three different sets of guidance, all coming from different people and all through multiple channels. And while students were being asked and advised to act by the government, some were being threatened with expulsion and fines by their university. This last week has been a lesson in how not to communicate during a pandemic. Yesterday, The Times reported that draft guidance for student accommodation prepared by the Scottish Government on the 30th of August gave an instruction to universities that, and I quote, "work and study that can be done remotely must be done so." This would have compelled universities to allow most students to work from home. But when the formal guidance was published on September the 1st, that phrase had been removed. This was not, as the First Minister has insisted, simply a change of wording. It was a fundamental change in the guidance. NUS say students should be studying from home, and university staff say most students should be studying from home. So who were the stakeholders the government consulted and agreed with over this change? And why exactly was that change made in the space of just 48 hours?
First Minister.
The draft guidance and the final guidance both contemplated a form of blended learning, of some work being done remotely, online at home, and some work being done physically face-to-face on campus. And I said this the other day, the quote that was in the Times, the first part of the paragraph was quoted, the next part wasn't, where it said where it cannot be done from home, then physical distancing must be followed, and it then went on to set out measures that universities needed to take in relation to physical distancing, cleanliness, hygiene and other matters. So it was always envisaged that there would be a form of blended learning. And this comes to the heart of it. You know, I'm pretty sure if we had decided that no student should return to a university campus, some would have said that was outrageous and we were denying students the opportunity to have access to learning. So we take these balanced decisions. There are no decisions in dealing with this pandemic that are categorically one way or the other. We're trying to find the right balance in a very difficult situation. And of course, in any circumstance where students or any other people are in physical proximity, a whole range of mitigating measures need to be taken, and that's what the guidance, both in the draft form and in the final form, set out. And the final point I would make, Richard Leonard talks about discipline and punishment. I couldn't have been clearer, the government couldn't have been clearer, and this applies to the general population. Of course, in any situation like this, you have to have enforcement as a backstop, but all of us should be supporting each other to do the right things, and students should not be getting blamed, they should not be having discipline unless people are flagrantly breaching the rules. There should be a supportive environment, and that's what we have been encouraging universities to do. And the final point is on different bits of guidance. Any government in a situation like this that comes up with a position and sticks rigidly to it, regardless of having to adapt to change in circumstances, is frankly not doing its job properly. We need to make sure that we continue to support people in difficult situations and try to build as much flexibility in as we possibly can. And that's what we will continue to do.
Richard Leonard.
Thank you. But there's been left behind a trail of confusion. And the confusion in the last week was not just over the rules for students, but over the lack of a due process. The guidance agreed between the Scottish Government and universities blurred the lines between mere advice and harsher, even criminal sanctions. This is a worrying trend. Since the need for local and targeted restrictions, new rules have been increasingly announced via late-night press releases, Twitter, and TV interviews. And Parliament has so far not had an opportunity to give its consent to local restrictions unless they have already expired. This is no way to govern. Parliament is supposed to provide checks and balances to government power. Without this, we risk a real democratic deficit. There has been a suggestion in the last 24 hours that the government is considering a two-week lockdown as a circuit breaker. Does the First Minister accept that such a move would require the consent of this Parliament? And will she agree to bring future regulations to a vote in Parliament before they are imposed?
First Minister.
Yes, I will give an undertaking that where it is possible, we will seek to bring things to Parliament in advance. Well, with the greatest of respect to people across the chamber, this is an infectious virus. We have to act quickly and flexibly sometimes if we have sudden spikes or outbreaks that are putting health and life at risk. And, you know, that is an important flexibility for government to have. The regulations, the restrictions made under the regulations are reviewed every 3 weeks. I've come here every 3 weeks and reported on that. The coronavirus legislation has to be reviewed periodically, and that process is underway right now. But yes, I do agree that we need to, as we go into a different phase of this, we need to try to build in more and earlier parliamentary scrutiny. And I would happily give an undertaking to do that, because I think it is important and welcome. But I would say to people across the chamber that it is also important that governments are able to act quickly in order to protect the population from the threat of a virus. And if there are particular restrictions that we put in place that Richard Leonard thinks are wrong, then perhaps he should get up now and tell us what ones those are, because he's agreed every week, every 3 weeks, when I've stood here and outlined the decisions that the Scottish Government were making, and that this is not a criticism, Richard Leonard has usually stood up and said he agreed with what we were doing. So, you know, I'm happy for parliamentary scrutiny, but let's not forget in the hurly-burly of politics that we are dealing with a virus here, and we've got an obligation to protect the public from it as best we possibly can.
Question number three, Alison Johnson.
Thank you. Today's Scotsman revealed that in the midst of the pandemic, one of NHS Scotland's COVID testing labs closed because it wasn't being used. This happened while the First Minister was rejecting Scottish Green calls for weekly testing for NHS staff and carers on the front line, a proposal backed by the Royal College of Emergency Medicine, the Royal College of Nursing and Scottish Care. Now, not deploying testing to its full to help control the virus is clearly a policy choice. While the World Health Organization has been clear from the start that we need to test, 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 the First Minister has chosen to follow the Scottish Government's approach. So can the First Minister explain why she doesn't agree with the World Health Organization and why her government allowed a testing lab to close down?
First Minister.
I address both issues. They are related, but I'll address them in turn. We test in line with clinical advice. We have massively increased the numbers in the groups that we are testing, but we take advice on when it is right and effective to test people and when it is less effective to test people, and we will continue to do that. And those decisions, of course, we have to have the capacity to implement a testing strategy, but the decisions we make about testing are driven by the clinical efficacy and the advice that come from that. On the issue of the laboratory was activated during the early stages of the pandemic because we didn't at that stage have the NHS capacity, and it was activated while we were building that NHS capacity. It was never designed to be a permanent provision. The daily capacity in NHS Lothian has, since that was activated, more than doubled, and that's since the beginning of April. And what that means is that labs like this one can return to the very important research work that they had been doing and which they want to return to. We're also currently developing regional hubs, which will give us longer-term sustainable additional NHS capacity, including in Lothian. So we're building the NHS capacity so that some of the provision that was used in the early stages can return to the purposes that it is initially for.
Alison Johnson.
Thank you. I mean, obviously, it's not either or. The fact of the matter is that we could have been doing 1,000 tests more a day, and the First Minister will be aware that there was inadequate testing available for when the schools returned in August, which we now know was avoidable. The University of Cambridge has offered all undergraduate and postgraduate students living in university accommodation a weekly COVID test, regardless of whether they show symptoms. And this is because they want to break the chain of infections before symptoms appear. And a similar asymptomatic testing service for students and staff is being delivered by Nottingham University. So instead of relying on the failed privatised UK testing system, these universities have taken things into their own hands to keep their staff and students safe. But this isn't happening in Scotland. The Scottish Government continues to follow an old and outdated testing strategy based on largely only testing those with symptoms. So can the First Minister explain why her government has allowed Scottish universities to fall behind when it comes to testing, and what her government will do to establish regular testing for university staff and students?
First Minister.
The testing strategy that we follow is kept under review all of the time and is updated in line with clinical advice when that is appropriate. There are differences of clinical opinion and scientific opinion about the efficacy of asymptomatic testing. In particularly vulnerable settings like care homes, we test many more people now who are asymptomatic, care home workers being the obvious example of that. The clinical advice right now is that we should be focusing in universities and testing those with symptoms in order that positive cases can be identified and contact tracing can be done to break those chains of transmission. And in the last week, in the walkthrough sites that we've established in university settings, there's been almost 4,000 tests in those walkthrough centres alone conducted in order to identify positive tests. So we continue to look at when and how we expand our testing. And I think it's really important that as we make those decisions, and as those decisions are rightly and legitimately scrutinised, we don't confuse the capacity and the issues of how we do the processing of tests from the clinical decisions that determine who we test and for what purposes. And we will continue to keep that under review, and that strategy will be informed by the best possible clinical advice.
Thank you. Question number four, Willie Rennie.
She cries to us. She's terrified of being alone. She's distraught and she's almost 94. Our hearts are breaking and Mum's spirit is broken. No one is saying the First Minister does not care about residents isolated from their families in care homes. So yesterday the Health Secretary said she was having more discussions tomorrow. But I'm sure the First Minister will understand my frustration that this is what she told me 2 weeks ago. More discussions will take more time, and time is precious for these people. When will families get to see their loved ones?
First Minister.
I do care, we all care deeply about this, and these are amongst, in a whole series of tough decisions governments everywhere are having to take right now, these are probably the toughest. Because on the one hand, I desperately want families of residents in care homes to have normal visiting. On the other hand, I desperately want to do everything we can to avoid the risk of COVID getting into care homes, because we know from our dreadful experience earlier in the year, the harm and the damage that that does, and the toll that can take in terms of death. So we are treating these issues very carefully, and we are considering these issues very, very deeply. We do want to get back to a greater degree of normality. The Health Secretary has met with family representatives. We are acutely aware of the importance of visiting for health and well-being. There has been a process already underway, which started in late June, if memory serves me correctly, which outlined a staged approach to the reintroduction of visits in care homes. That is underway, starting with outdoor visits, and now care homes are looking to reintroduce indoor visiting. And the restrictions that were announced for the population last week have not affected that. And in fact, part of the reason for putting these restrictions in place is to try to get the virus under control so we don't have a situation where we're not able to proceed to greater flexibility around care home visiting. So these are difficult issues. They do take time because they need the best clinical consideration and advice, and we will continue to take these decisions with the greatest possible care, but also seek to do that in a way that enables families to have as much normality around their visits to, care of, and interaction with their loved ones in care homes as possible.
I do understand that these decisions are tough, but they won't get any easier if we keep on delaying those decisions. And that's what the families want. They want to see their loved ones. It's been months now, and they are desperate. And I know the First Minister understands that, but can I just urge her to try and move faster on this, because that's what the families need. The First Minister knows about the horrendous problems with the flu vaccine programme in Fife. Thousands of calls missed and tens of thousands of anxious and angry people. There's been traffic jams at flu centres in Edinburgh, and the NHS and the Borders has apologised for the problems there. This should be a warning to the Scottish Government for the rollout of the COVID vaccine. From school exams to university terms, the Scottish Government has not been great at hearing warnings and acting on them effectively. So if we are to get the COVID vaccine, we need to be ready. What is the First Minister doing now to make sure the rush this week with the flu does not turn into a stampede in a few months with any COVID vaccine?
First Minister.
Can I firstly just return to the issue of care homes before I move on to issues of vaccine? And I absolutely take Willie Rennie's points about care home visiting in the spirit they're intended, and they are extremely legitimate points. I would simply say that delay, while none of us want to delay things unduly, on issues like this, we have to take care that we get these decisions right. And I would simply point out the fact that, unfortunately, we are again in a rising tide of COVID, where we are starting to see cases again in care homes, which we want to make sure that we have all of the appropriate protections in place so that we don't see a repeat of the experience in care homes that we had earlier in the year. So these are difficult decisions, and I'm not saying that just to excuse that we haven't got to the point Willie Rennie is asking me to get to. I'm simply underlining why it is so important to get those decisions right, and if unfortunately, sometimes that means taking a bit of time over them. That is for the best possible reasons. On the flu vaccine, flu vaccine programme actually officially starts today, and I would encourage everybody who is eligible for the flu vaccine to take it up. We've seen in recent week's scientific opinion about the particular dangers to people of getting COVID and flu together. So we should all be encouraging people to take up the flu vaccine. There have been some issues in certain health boards. Fife Health Board, for example, mentioned by Willie Rennie, has already increased the numbers of call handlers, the numbers of staff that are working on this, and measures have been put in place to ensure that the resources are there for everybody who comes forward for an appointment for the flu vaccine gets that. For people who perhaps are not aware of this, we are delivering the vaccine in a different way this year because of the risk of COVID in doing it in the way we normally do. On the related issue of a possible COVID vaccine, and I would dearly love to be in the position in a few months of being able to start rolling out a COVID vaccine. I genuinely don't know whether that will be possible. We already have a programme board looking at the practical issues around that. There are discussions with the UK government around procurement, what the likely volumes are that would be available. We don't yet know who would be the priority groups, because we don't yet know what vaccine is likely to be approved first and who it is likely to be most effective in. But we are very plugged into all of these discussions, and we have that planning process already underway, so that as we do get more information, we can take those decisions in an orderly fashion. There is, I read an embargo copy last night, and I would encourage everybody to read a report published today, which is quite sobering. It's optimistic about the progress around vaccines, but also quite sobering. It's a report produced for the Royal Society, and sobering about some of the practical issues to get from here to actually starting to vaccinate large numbers of the population. But the Scottish Government is already, as I say, working through and thinking how we work through all these issues when more information becomes available.
Thank you. Question number five, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Treasury Officer. To ask the First Minister what extra support the Scottish Government can provide to Police Scotland to assist with the additional pressures being placed on officers dealing with COVID-19 measures.
First Minister.
Police Scotland has been at the front and centre of the response to COVID and continues to work closely with partners, including local authorities and the NHS, to support the response. The Chief Constable has been clear that maintaining and supporting the health and well-being of the workforce is a key priority, and we continue to be very grateful to police officers and staff who put themselves in harm's way every day to protect the public. This year we've increased funding for policing by £60 million to more than £1.2 billion, but we know that COVID is an unprecedented event which could lead to expenditure above this budget allocation. So we continue to work closely with the Police Authority and Police Scotland to monitor and manage the financial impacts of COVID on the policing budget.
Stuart McMillan.
I thank the First Minister for that reply. The First Minister will know the challenges being placed upon Police Scotland throughout COVID-19 and how they are genuinely trying to keep every single one of us safe. The First Minister will also be aware of the spate of firebomb attacks in my constituency in recent weeks and the reported links to our drugs feud. Can the First Minister provide an assurance to my community that Police Scotland and Inverclyde are receiving additional resources to help them track down the perpetrators of these attacks, and can she confirm that having a single police force actually makes it easier for additional resources to be moved around the country when it's required?
First Minister.
I was appalled to hear of the attacks in Greenock, and I certainly share Stuart McMillan's concerns. The policing of any incidents like this is an operational matter for the Chief Constable, but I am able to confirm that Police Scotland has increased its presence in the area in an effort to prevent further attacks, and I would certainly urge the local community to contact Police Scotland if they have any information that may assist with the ongoing investigation. Issues are raised in terms of single national police force. I think a single service brings many benefits to our communities, not least through providing flexibility and equality of support. And the additional funding that I mentioned in my original answer is helping to ensure that officer numbers are maintained, which I think is crucial during these times of unprecedented demand on our policing service.
Thank you. Question number six, Michelle Ballantyne.
Thank you. To ask the First Minister whether the Scottish Government can guarantee that everyone who has been referred for a winter flu vaccination will be able to get one.
First Minister.
We've worked with the UK Government and other devolved administrations to secure enough vaccine for all those who are eligible, in line with our planning assumption, which is an uptake of 2.4 million people. If that is exceeded, we will then use best clinical evidence to prioritise vaccine supply for the most vulnerable. While health boards are responsible for delivering the vaccine, we work closely with them and other partners to ensure safe delivery of the programme. Boards will use the delivery model that is most suitable for their local circumstances while maintaining a COVID-safe environment. As I mentioned a few moments ago, this year's vaccination programme formally starts today, but delivery is already underway in many boards, and I would encourage everyone to make us aware of any issues with the programme so that we can work quickly with boards to resolve them, and I would encourage everyone who is eligible for the flu vaccine to take up the opportunity.
Michelle Ballantyne.
Presiding Officer, as the First Minister is already aware, many of my constituents in the Lothians and Borders have already been contacting us to say that they were told to come for a flu jab appointment, only to have to wait in long queues or even been turned away on arrival. We all know some areas of the health service are under strain at the moment, but this is clearly unacceptable. Our most vulnerable have already been let down by the Scottish Government's approach to the coronavirus crisis. They cannot be let down again in a possible winter flu crisis. So can I ask, does the First Minister know how many people in Scotland are eligible for the vaccine in the October phase? And what percentage of those vaccines are the NHS aiming to administer by the end of November?
First Minister.
I don't have the particular figure of the different phases in front of me, but the Health Secretary will write to the member this afternoon with that information. We do this every year, but this year eligibility for the flu vaccine has been extended. We make sure that the prioritisation for available stocks, and remember that there is, we have to procure stocks, we work with the UK government to do that, and there are global supplies of these stocks, but we make sure both in the amount of stock we have and in the phasing of the administering of those stocks that the most vulnerable are catered for in an appropriate way. We are delivering the programme differently this year for essential reasons because of the risk of COVID, but all health boards are fully engaged in making sure that the flu vaccine system is delivered effectively and efficiently this year, and I think all of us should be encouraging everybody who is eligible for the vaccine to take it up. It's important every year, but it is particularly important this year, and those who are entitled will be and will have had or will be getting the contact in order to make the appropriate appointment.
Thank you. Question number 7, Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what plans the Scottish Government has for NHS Louisa Jordan in light of reports that it has awarded a contract for its decommissioning.
First Minister.
The lease for the Louisa Jordan currently runs until the end of April 2021. If it is necessary to do so, we will negotiate an extension to the lease if the facility is still needed to support our pandemic response. In the meantime, we are perfectly sensibly putting in place arrangements to allow the facility to be decommissioned when it is eventually no longer needed. But currently, the Louisa Jordan has been used for outpatient clinics, diagnostic tests and educational activities. Thankfully, so far, it has not been required for COVID patients. But the reason we have extended its lease is so that it is there over the winter period should it prove to be necessary.
Monica Lennon.
The First Minister for her response. NHS lockdown is having serious impacts on treatment waiting times and patient care, and worryingly it was reported this week that a higher number of patients are presenting with more advanced forms of cancer. So whilst it's good that we have that temporary additional capacity at Louisa Jordan helping to alleviate the known COVID pressures the First Minister's outlined, it does make you wonder how many Louisa Jordans do we actually need to clear the waiting times backlog. Can I ask the First Minister, in light of the pressures on the NHS estate in terms of space requirements and physical capacity, and we know that there's a maintenance and repairs backlog of almost £1 billion, and 10% of those repairs are classed as high risk. What is the government doing to support the NHS estate right across Scotland to increase that capacity, and how is she going to do that in the next few months?
First Minister.
Well, I mean, there is an ongoing maintenance programme in the NHS, and that is important to ensure that the current estate is in the state that it needs to be. Obviously, one of the issues we've had to deal with in the past 6 months is reduced capacity because health boards and hospitals have had to deal with COVID and also make sure there is capacity there to deal with COVID should cases rise. So the NHS Louisa Jordan right now was originally put there to make sure that if we needed extra capacity for COVID, that would be there, and that will be available over the winter if we need it. But when it's not needed for that right now, it is helping to do other things. So in the
period since the beginning of July and the middle of September, around 2,000 people have been seen at the Louisa Jordan, and they're intending to increase outpatient clinics there over the next few weeks. But that facility there is helping to mitigate for reduced capacity in other hospitals because of the need to make sure there is a COVID contingency there. The Health Secretary will be setting out, I think next week, plans for the winter and how the NHS intends to cope with the variety of winter pressures it faces, but also will update at that stage on the ongoing progress to remobilise the NHS and to restart services that were paused because of COVID.
Thank you very much. We've got a number of supplementary questions. Alistair Allen, to be followed by Brian Whittle. Alistair Allen.
Over the last week, the community in Uist has experienced a significant outbreak of COVID, with 24 cases now being confirmed. This represents a very significant scale of outbreak within a small island community, particularly a community where there are finite local health services available other than by air ambulance. It is an extremely concerning development, and I'm sure all of our thoughts are with the families affected. Is the First Minister able to give an update on the situation and the government's response to it?
First Minister.
Well, my last update on the situation was that 22 cases have so far been identified on South Uist. That includes, as I understand it, 2 cases at the secondary school and 4 cases at a care home. All schools on Uist were closed on Monday for deep cleaning. Schools have reopened today, with the exception of a couple of schools that will remain closed until after the October break, and full-time online interactive teaching will be available from today for the pupils of those schools. All staff and residents at the care home have been tested. Routine weekly testing for all staff was undertaken again on Wednesday, and contact tracing has been undertaken for all identified contacts, and a further incident management group meeting is scheduled to take place tomorrow. We are working in partnership with all health boards at the moment to support the response to incidents like this, and in respect in particular of Islands, the Islands Minister will meet the leaders of Western Isles Council today to listen to views on recent lockdown measures.
Thank you. Brian Whittle, to be followed by James Kelly.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister may be aware that Mala Engine Systems, based in Kilmarnock, has just announced a plan to shed up to 45 jobs. That's another blow to Kilmarnock, which has already saw the closure of Wabtec Rail Engineering Plant earlier this year, with a loss of 100 jobs. So can I ask what support the Scottish Government can offer the staff of Mala, and will the First Minister commit to examine further steps that can be taken to avoid further job losses in this sector and secure the future of engineering across East Ayrshire?
First Minister.
I mean, obviously, I regret the situation that the member has outlined, and obviously it's an extremely difficult time for the company, but in particular for workers and their families. We will always seek to work with companies wherever possible to try to find ways of avoiding redundancies and supporting continued employment. Where that's not possible, our PACE initiative will step in to work with affected employees to support them into alternative employment as quickly as possible, and the PACE initiative will be available in that case, as it will in all cases. Obviously, we are in a very challenging situation right now for employment generally across the country, indeed across the UK, which is why we also continue to constructively discuss with the UK government how the furlough scheme can be more comprehensively replaced than the initiatives that were outlined by the Chancellor last week.
James Kelly, to be followed by George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I raise with the First Minister the sad case of the 8 deaths at the Alexander Thompson Hotel in Glasgow? The hotel is used as temporary accommodation for homeless people. This is a tragic case where people feeling isolated and living in difficult circumstances during lockdown have lost their lives. So can I ask the First Minister what steps are being taken to establish the cause of death in the 7 cases where that remains unexplained, and also what measures are being taken in light of this incident for government and councils to ensure that people living in temporary accommodation for homeless people are properly supported?
First Minister.
This is obviously a very serious issue and also a very sad issue that James Kelly has raised. I am extremely sad to hear of the deaths at the Alexander Thompson Hotel in Glasgow and obviously extend my sympathies to all of their friends and family. I hope James Kelly and others will understand, though, that I'm not able to comment further on that at the moment because investigations into cause of death are currently ongoing and it would not be appropriate for me to do so. We work closely, though, with a range of stakeholders to help people out of homelessness. Obviously, the reasons for homelessness can be varied and complex, which is why our Housing First approach is so important, which focuses on finding settled permanent accommodation for people and then providing wraparound services to help with other issues that they may be experiencing. And we continue to take forward the recommendations of the Homelessness and Rough Sleeping Task Force in order that we can, through a variety of different actions, hopefully make homelessness and rough sleeping in Scotland a thing of the past.
Thank you. George Adam, to be followed by Liz Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what help can be offered to WJ&W Lang, a company that's operated at the heart of Paisley since 1872, and its current decision to mothball its Seed Hill site due to the coronavirus pandemic. With the strain this will put on the workforce at this time, can the First Minister help in securing discussions with Lang's about possible alternatives and any further assistance available?
First Minister.
Well, I was disappointed, obviously, to hear of the announcement by the Scottish Leather Group, which is, of course, the parent company of WJ and W Lang, that they are to consolidate tannery operations at Bridge of Weir. I know this will be a difficult time for staff, their families and the local area, which will be affected by this decision. I can report that Scottish Enterprise has been engaging directly with the company in recent months to offer support during the ongoing consultation period and will continue to engage with them going forward. The Business Minister also spoke with the company to offer the full support of the Scottish Government during this difficult time. And as I said, in relation to an earlier question, our PACE initiative, of course, stands ready to help any employee who is faced with the prospect of redundancy.
Liz Smith, to be followed by Neil Bibby.
Thank you. Could I ask the First Minister if she could update Parliament on when the Scottish Government will give a formal response to this Parliament's unanimous calls to safeguard the future of Scotland's outdoor education centres?
First Minister.
There is a ministerial meeting with representatives of the outdoor education sector today, I understand, and we'll be happy to give an update after that. We are fully committed to supporting outdoor education providers. They offer a really important service and experience for young people, and it's vital that we do everything we can to protect that. There are obvious restrictions and limitations on what they can do right now, which none of us like, but are unfortunately necessary. What we have been focusing on doing is trying to maximise the things that the sector can do and give support for that, but perhaps it is more appropriate for me to ask it. I think it is Richard Lockhead that is meeting them later on to write to the member after that with an update.
Neil Bibby, who joins us remotely, to be followed by Kenneth Gibson. Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We all want to maximise uptake of the flu vaccine this year. However, older people in places like Johnston and villages like Laquinnock, Kilbarkin, Bridgeweir and Houston and others in Renfrewshire are concerned that the vaccine will be administered centrally from St Mirren's football grounds in the north of Paisley, not in their own communities. As the First Minister will be aware, public health advice is to avoid public transport and is to avoid car sharing. And a number of my constituents without access to a car would have to take multiple bus journeys to get to the football stadium and back. Some do not want to take this risk and some will not take this risk. Does the First Minister therefore accept that a lack of transport is a barrier for many people who need to get the flu jab? And will she ask Renfrewshire Health and Social Care Partnership to consider additional sites for administering the vaccine this winter?
First Minister.
I'll ask the Health Secretary to engage with the local partnership to make sure that they have arrangements in place that are genuinely accessible for people. I hope everybody understands why there is a different delivery mechanism for the flu vaccine this year. It is unavoidable because of the COVID risks, but it remains essential. In fact, I would say it's more essential than ever this year that getting the vaccine is available to people and possible for people in an accessible way. So we'll take that issue up with the local partnership and I'll ask the Health Secretary to write to the member when she's had the opportunity to do so.
Thank you. Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, you'll be aware that yesterday TSB announced the closure of 73 branches across Scotland, three of which, Kilburnie, Largs and Saltcoats, are in my constituency. This will leave many of my constituents at even greater risk of financial exclusion, and local staff will lose their livelihood. Far too many communities in North Ayrshire and across Scotland now have no access to banking in their towns. Does the First Minister agree that establishing banking hubs is one potential solution? And have Scottish ministers contacted the TSB and UK ministers to seek a reversal of this decision, given that powers over banking are reserved to the UK government?
First Minister.
I would certainly urge banks to consider all possible solutions in relation to access to banking facilities. This whole area is reserved to the UK government, but we have consistently stressed to the sector the importance of financial inclusion, and we've also repeatedly lobbied the UK government to do more to ensure access to cash and banking facilities for all. This is a worrying time for all concerned, and we will continue to urge banks to listen to and address the real concerns their customers have on their ability to access services, and will engage with banks through the Banking and Economy Forum and the Financial Services Advisory Board to ensure everything possible is being done to mitigate the impact of closures on communities affected by this and other recent announcements.
Graeme Simpson, to be followed by David Stewart.
Thank you. I just want to press the First Minister again on parliamentary scrutiny of COVID laws, because I raised it last week and it's been mentioned again by Richard Leonard today. The UK government budged on this yesterday, and I want to just say why this actually matters. When regulations were brought in first here on the mandatory wearing of face coverings in shops, we had the legal situation where it was legal not to wear a face covering in any shop if it provided currency exchange facilities. So you could go into a shop with a post office, you could go into a supermarket where you could get foreign currency. That was the legal situation. And the government then had to correct that. But Parliament had had no prior sight, no prior scrutiny of that legislation. That's why this stuff matters. So I get that government has to act quickly, but this Parliament can also act quickly. So will the First Minister pledge to correct what the Speaker of the Commons yesterday described as a totally unsatisfactory approach to secondary legislation?
First Minister.
I do agree that this is important and matters, so I will happily give an undertaking to further consider these issues and consider and ask the Mike Russell, who is the minister who oversees the coronavirus legislation, to come back with some proposals for discussion with Parliament about how we enhance and strengthen parliamentary scrutiny, and to do so wherever possible, which is what the UK government said yesterday, of course, at an earlier stage, recognising that there will be circumstances in which governments have to move very quickly. As I understand it, and I'll be corrected if I'm wrong about this, right now parliamentary committees can sit not just on parliamentary sitting days, but at any point in order to scrutinise regulations that are being put forward, often at very short notice. So there is the provision already for some advanced scrutiny, but I absolutely accept that the situation we are working in right now, not just in this instance, but in a whole range of different ways, is not ideal and is not what we would choose in normal circumstances. But as we go further into this whole experience, and as we go into the winter, I think it is right and proper and perfectly reasonable for Parliament to ask Government to consider whether there are further steps we can take to enhance the scrutiny that Parliament is able to bring to bear.
David Stewart, to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister will be well aware of the recent publication of the 2019 Scottish Health Survey, which identified the scale of poor health in Scotland before the pandemic. Over a half of all adults are living with long-term conditions, and a fifth of all men have some form of heart disease or diabetes. Is the First Minister concerned that a failure to improve Scotland's health, especially in disadvantaged areas, has created additional challenges for responding to COVID-19?
First Minister.
There are very long-standing and well-known health inequalities in Scotland, as there are in many countries, and we have a number of initiatives and have had a number of initiatives to try to tackle and close these inequalities. There is no doubt that COVID has both
underlined and illustrated and also exacerbated some of those inequalities. And what it certainly says to me is that as we hopefully start to come out of the COVID crisis, we must all redouble our efforts to deal with the underlying inequalities that are there. And that will take action across a whole range of fronts, from preventative health measures, which this Parliament has got a very good record on, through to different ways of providing services in some of our most deprived communities. So I think there is not just an opportunity, but a need to do that as we come out of the acute phase of this crisis.
John Mason, to be followed by Alex Crowell-Hamilton.
Thank you very much. The UK Internal Market Bill is working its way through Westminster, and our own Finance and Constitution Committee has heard major concerns about this bill. If the Scottish Parliament refuses legislative consent, does the First Minister have any message for Boris Johnson?
First Minister.
Well, if the Scottish Parliament refuses to grant consent to this bill, then any UK government worth its salt would do the right thing and respect the views of this Parliament. I think that is a fairly basic statement of democracy. And if it doesn't do that, if it insists on legislating over the head of this Parliament in devolved areas, then all the UK government succeeds in doing is demonstrating that they have no respect for this Parliament, and that actually if this Parliament is to have the power to make its own decisions, then it needs to stop being a devolved Parliament and become an independent Parliament, so the UK government can't do that. So, you know, perhaps if, given that often appeals to this UK government to do the right thing for the right reasons often fall in deaf ears, perhaps I should appeal to them to do the right thing for their own self-interested reasons, because the way they're acting right now, as we can see plenty evidence of, is each and every single day building the support and the case for Scottish independence. Now, I'm happy with that, but I suspect they aren't.
Alex Crowell-Hamilton, to be followed by Keith Brown.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. New government guidance has restricted parent and baby groups to no more than 5 adults per class. This has already caused several such groups to signal that they will have to fold, as these numbers are not sustainable. The First Minister will recognise that new parents accessing these groups, particularly mums, will have spent much of lockdown shielding while pregnant, while other restrictions will prevent them from visiting other new parents or family support networks. The impact of all of this on perinatal mental health cannot be overstated. So can I ask the First Minister, given that these same parents can access bars and gyms in far greater numbers, what scientific basis exists behind limiting these classes to 5 adults at a time?
First Minister.
I understand the sentiments behind that question, and I've had a number of contacts from new parents making the same points. I absolutely understand the importance of parent and baby groups, and perinatal mental health is a key and important priority for the government that we've invested significantly in. I also understand the risks of large numbers of adults coming together in increasing transmission of the virus. So again, we're trying to balance all of these things. I have just this morning asked the Chief Medical Officer and the National Clinical Director for some additional clinical advice to see whether there is more flexibility we can build in there. And once I have that, I'll be able to see what that is. We always try to build as much flexibility into these things as possible. But fundamentally here, we are trying to stop an infectious virus spreading from person to person and household to household, and therefore across a whole range of different areas of our life, we're having to accept restrictions that normally we would not ever do, and none of us want to be living under. But I appreciate the importance of this and the sensitivity of this, which is why, as I say this morning, I've asked for some additional advice.
Keith Brown, who joins us remotely, to be followed by Colin Smith. Keith Brown.
The First Minister will be aware that the Joseph Rowntree Foundation and over 60 other organisations have written to the Chancellor to call for the £20 a week increase to universal credit to be made permanent and to extend the same support to claimants of legacy benefits. Does the First Minister agree that maintaining the increase beyond next April is crucial, particularly now that the UK Government has failed to extend the furlough scheme, and that Scottish Tories in this Parliament have failed to support Scottish businesses, trade unions and other political parties in the extension of that scheme, and in particular that the Chancellor must act or risk plunging hundreds of thousands of people into poverty?
First Minister.
Yes, I do agree. I think if we don't see further extension of the furlough scheme, then we will have a wave of avoidable redundancies over the next period. And if that happens, then it is the case that responsibility for that will lie with the UK government. But there is also a need to act now to stop more people falling into poverty. We have already urged the UK government to make the uplift to universal credit of £20 permanent and indeed to extend it further. I hope the UK government will commit to making these changes now before more people are pushed into poverty. We know that thousands will face significant financial strain when the furlough scheme phases out at the end of this month. So it's not too late for the UK government to change its position on these things, ensure that social security support is adequate to support people, and also to extend the furlough scheme properly to give businesses the certainty they so badly need, and in the process save what is estimated to be around 60,000 jobs across Scotland.
Colin Smith, to be followed by Christine Graham.
Thank you, President Officer. The decision by the preferred bidder not to go ahead with the purchase of Prestwick Airport due to the aviation downturn will be a huge blow to the 300 workers directly employed at Prestwick and the many thousands across Ayrshire whose jobs rely on the airport. So will the First Minister now listen to the calls by the unions, Unite and GMB, for sector-specific support from the Scottish Government? It's not just the UK Government, but from the Scottish Government as well. Ensure that any business support does have conditionality attached that protects jobs and paying conditions. And will the Government bring forward options for testing at airports with follow-up tests to at least make the possibility of reducing quarantine something that will be considered?
First Minister.
There's a number of issues in there. Firstly, on Prestwick Airport, COVID's obviously, as the member alluded to, had an impact on the aviation sector globally, and unfortunately affected the planned sale process of Prestwick Airport. The company selected as preferred bidder does now not wish to complete the purchase at this time. That's disappointing, but obviously we understand the reasons for it. So we'll consider now further options for Glasgow Prestwick Airport, but we do continue to believe it has a role to play in Scotland's aviation sector. In terms of the wider issues, we always seek to ensure that when we are making funding available to companies, then fair work principles are absolutely embedded in that, and we will continue to do so. We will continue to consider within our own resources support we can make available to businesses, but, and this is a statement of fact, the Scottish Government's budget, unlike the UK Government's budget, because they have the recourse to borrowing powers that we don't have, our budget is finite, and therefore once we have allocated it as we have, it is not possible without taking money away from one priority to always give more money to others, which is why we are having discussions with the UK government about further support for business. And in fact, we've asked the UK government to convene an aerospace task force, which would obviously include some of the issues around aviation, and that has the support of the other devolved administrations and trade unions. So we'll do everything we can, and we will continue to seek to persuade the UK government to play its full part as well.
Christine Graham, to be followed by Neil Findlay.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Further to the exchange with Neil Bibby, I've been contacted by elderly constituents in Melrose and Lauder who are now being required under new flu vaccine arrangements, which I understand, to travel many miles, often with limited access to public transport, which in any event they're reluctant to use due to COVID. To access the flu vaccine, would the Scottish Government consider the introduction of mobile vaccination facilities, particularly for elderly people in rural areas such as mine?
First Minister.
It is the responsibility of health boards to deliver the vaccine programme, but we will continue to discuss with health boards the ways in which they are ensuring accessibility for people to the programme, and mobile facilities may well have a part to play in that. So the Health Secretary will continue to discuss these issues with health boards, and I'll ask her on the specific local issues that Christine Graham has raised to come back to her with more detail when she's had the chance to do so.
Neil Findlay, to be followed by Bill Kidd.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Today a group of MPs on the House of Commons Health Select Committee said that there should be weekly routine testing of all NHS staff, and they cannot understand why it hasn't been introduced. I believe this from the very start of the crisis. The vast majority of NHS staff in Scotland have never been tested. So why aren't we doing routine weekly testing of the people who are in the front line, keeping people safe and alive
during the pandemic?
First Minister.
We test certain groups of NHS staff, and the groups that we are currently testing, like all of the groups that we test across the population, are advised by clinical priority, and we will continue to look at options for extending that. Capacity around testing is important. Obviously, you need to have the capacity to take the samples and process the test. We are substantially expanded NHS capacity. We have plans to do that further over the remainder of this year. That will make the wherewithal available, but who and how often is tested has to be driven by clinical advice and clinical prioritisation, and we will continue to take these decisions as carefully as possible. I've not yet had the opportunity to see the Select Committee report, but I will read it with interest.
Bill Kidd, to be followed by Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, the new self-isolation support grant is very welcome, and it will ensure that people don't experience financial hardship as a result of doing the right thing. Can you outline how the fund will be delivered and how those in need of support can access it?
First Minister.
We confirmed yesterday that the fund will be administered through the Scottish Welfare Fund, which is already established and is tried and tested in terms of making crisis support available to people who need it. It will be available to people on low incomes. It will be targeted at those on universal credit who will lose income if they are not able to work through the advice to self-isolate, but we want to have some flexibility where people out with that category but who genuinely need crisis support may be able to access it, and we'll be making available information through the usual channels to people in a practical sense so that they know exactly how they can access that support.
And Jackie Bailey, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a member of the committee considering the handling of harassment, Minister, that the SNP government is being disrespectful to the committee and by extension to the Parliament. This is not about her evidence or her attendance at the committee. She knows that that is a red herring. I know she has recused herself, but there is no getting away from the fact that she is the leader of the Scottish government and the leader of the SNP. So it is in her gift to make sure that they are open and transparent. Contrary to her briefing, the information provided at this point has been partial. Witnesses come before the committee with surprisingly difficult memories, and there is a complete refusal to hand over the legal advice for the judicial review, which can be done if the government wish to do so. So will the First Minister authorise the release of all the material to the committee as previously promised? Will she ensure that no documents held by the Scottish Government, the Crown Office, or the SNP are destroyed before the committee finishes its own honour her previous commitment? Can she explain to the Chamber what on earth the Scottish Government and the SNP have to hide?
First Minister.
Well, firstly, I don't consider the evidence I have already given to the committee and the evidence I am keen to offer in oral session to the committee to be a red herring. I think it is really important and a part of my responsibility. In terms of the government has made available substantial material. The only material the government has not yet made available is because of legal reasons, and has already said that in respect of some of that material, it is initiating legal proceedings to try to put itself in a position where it can hand over that material, and I think that is the right and proper thing to do. In relation to the SNP of course had no involvement in the Scottish Government complaints process, but the SNP will also put forward answers to the questions that the committee asks of it. It has already done so, as anybody can go to the committee website and see with their own two eyes, and will continue to cooperate fully. I absolutely intend to cooperate fully. I look forward to the opportunity to be able to share my evidence with the committee, and I'm respecting the process of the committee. I do think it really begs a lot of questions, though, when we have members of the committee, in relation to me, literally after every evidence session, saying that I am not answering questions when I have submitted written evidence and I am waiting for the opportunity to give evidence in person.
Thank you very much, and that concludes First Minister. Point of order from Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. In her exchange with Ruth Davidson, the First Minister implied that members of the harassment handling inquiry had leaked the WhatsApp messages discussed in their exchange to the press. That's a serious allegation. It's also untrue. The first committee members learned of the messages was in an email from Clarks, to which were attached images of the messages, from which I quote, "We are now aware that details of the contents of these messages have also been given to the media, and so we wanted to ensure that members were cited on this before reading about it in the media." So, Presiding Officer, can I ask you to advise me of the appropriate procedure by which the First Minister can either correct the official report or present evidence to Parliament to substantiate her claim? Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Cole-Hamilton. That's not a procedural point for me to rule on. There are a number of methods by which the member can ask a question of the First Minister and she can reply, including through written questions, letters and so on. However, that's not a point of order. The member's point is on the record. And on that note, that ends First Minister's questions, and I suspend this meeting of Parliament.